of violent content. Parental discretion is advised.
It's from
a film.
A movie from the '80s, which was one of my favourite films when I was a little kid. And it's like from there's one part in the film. It's called Excalibur. Did I say that?
No.
It's from a movie called Excalibur. And just used to like it when I was a kid, and there's one section where the Merlin is doing like this incantation kind of thing. And it's part of the what it says basically.
Simple as that.
Yeah. Means serpent's breath.
Is this your first visit to Plymouth?
It is mine, yeah. Sorry, it's I'm just thinking about Merlin. Get on with it.
Actually, isn't King Arthur from, supposed to be from Cornwall?
Yes, yeah, so Tintagel.
Yeah.
It might not be next door, but to us that's not far away.
Yeah. Tintagel. There's a castle there, right?
That's right, the remains of one.
Yeah. You have a little tiny little pathway to get to it, right?
That's it.
Spooky.
Like been.
Never been there.
No, I've seen pictures of it.
But the brother's been there.
Yeah. We haven't. I think I've been here, but we haven't played here before.
No, certainly not played here before.
I think the nearest place you've played is like Essex or somewhere.
Yeah. No, I played Exeter.
Exeter. Hang on.
It's where I threw Shy down the stairs.
Yeah. You work together to write and record everything. What's the main reason for doing this?
I don't understand the question. Because we're in the same band together.
Yeah. Why just the two of you? Why not have a complete band and work on it?
In fairness, if you had a seven piece, would you say, have you ever considered being a duo?
Yeah, I suppose.
I think it's because that people ask that question reasonably often, and I think it's a bit of an odd question that just seems like a normal question, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, it's even something comparable. No one says to Slayer, have you considered just having the bass and drums? Yeah. It's just, well, you wouldn't because you'd need the other stuff. Well, we've got what we need, so.
Yeah. I mean, when we play live, we have other people play.
Yeah, but
I mean, for writing the music, it means. I mean, I think some people want to be in a band because they want that whole band experience. Oh, you know, I want to write songs together and do everything together, but. We've never really been like that because, I don't know, we've just always done everything ourselves. And rather than being like, oh, I need someone to play the bass or I need someone to play the drums, we just figure out the song, we just write the songs, complete songs, and then just
Which way do you work on your songs and when you start writing them? You work with the lyrics first or the bass or guitar?
Same at the same time, really. Like, Dave will always have thousands of notes on things he's been thinking about, and I'll just write some music, and then we'll go together and just kind of he'll listen to the music and get like so a certain vibe of a song or something.
Yeah, those are the music and the lyrics are created sort of simultaneously, separately, and never the twain shall meet sort of thing. We don't really know what we're doing, but how do you think of stuff in the first place? You think of a riff first? You think of a drum pattern first? Or
Could just be a song. Sometimes a song. Sometimes, remember when I wrote from Shit and Piss, I was standing in my dad's pantry, and then the whole song came into my head, and I had to like dash into the studio, and record it real quick, and that's actually one of our most popular songs.
Just thinking, your dad must be left standing there going, either he's got the shits or he's had an idea.
Yeah,
he went oh and ran out. I don't know why.
So there's also one other funny one. There's a song called Fire and Fucking Pigs, and that was actually written while Dave went to the bathroom.
In the
duration of Dave having the shit.
Yeah.
The whole song. Because he needed an extra song.
Yeah, it wasn't the whole song, was it?
It was
I'll write something quick. So I went for a crap, came back, and I sang on it. Then I went away, and you finished it, didn't you?
Yeah.
So I didn't know what it sounded like until we got the album.
So obviously, if you're doing that, you write and record together. Do you do that here or in America?
We don't write together. We write individually more. But we record together.
Right. So when you come up with lyrics, and you're in the UK and you're over in America,
Yeah.
Is that just email each other or Skype or whatever?
No, don't even do that.
WhatsApp we usually
He doesn't normally hear the songs until we're actually recording.
Yeah.
No. Not normally. It's like, that's just the way we work. It's always worked best for us to be like more spontaneous.
Yeah.
Well, I don't even know if it's not even a thing, is it? It's just the way it's happened.
Yeah.
So like I'll be like, yeah, cool, I've nearly got enough songs, and be like, cool. And then he'll come over there or I'll come here. I'll be like, okay, let's do this one first, and I'll play him a song, and it'll be like, he'll like listen to it and get like an atmosphere or a vibe or something from that, and be like, okay, these words I've written will fit that, and then we just kind of comes together.
So I'll have I don't know 30 odd ideas, and just get a sensation from it as to which one would be most appropriate, and then sort of hammer the stuff I've already got into a shape that fits the music. So it's like the way I sometimes say it in interviews I've done before is it's more like reacting to the music, if you know what I mean, rather than going, it has to be like this, and then if it doesn't happen to fit, shoehorning it in. You know, it's more organic. I think it comes across as a more genuine, graspable thing if it's a more fluid, interactive process with the music. Like, you know,
so. Sometimes as well, he'll give me a song title sometimes. That happened on Domine. There's a few songs on that you get.
Yeah, it was the one time I sent loads of like titles and explanations and that for you to get the feeling for the, writing the music.
Final Destruction. That's because if it's the lyrics.
Yeah, it's like tapping the syllables.
It could be anyway. There's no.
It's a very interesting way of doing things.
Yeah.
Quite unique, I would have thought.
There isn't really any. I haven't got any like rules or anything. Just kind of just happens really. Whatever works.
Well, some people write stuff by jamming, don't they?
Yeah, I could never do that.
That's not our way of doing it.
Most bands would go to a rehearsal and then, I've wrote this riff, and then someone wouldn't like that riff, and then this person wouldn't like that riff, and then you end up jamming, playing the riff for 3 hours, and then end up being like, oh, sounds shit, let's not even use it. You know?
It sounds like a description Paul would give, that, doesn't it? It's worked really hard, and you work together, and it's just crap, and you throw it in the bin.
Do you get that a lot? Do you throw a lot away, or just say
no? We don't. Nothing.
It doesn't play.
Every song we've written is on an album.
Yeah.
There's two that aren't on this album actually.
On this album I ended up writing way too much music, so there's two bonus tracks which will come out at some point.
Yeah.
There's actually two songs that I didn't even sing on because it just wasn't the right thing.
Right. But that's about it.
Yeah.
Yeah. How difficult is it to recreate your sound live?
It's kind
of. We thought it'd be impossible to find a drummer. Do you remember originally? Drummer, play that.
Yeah. Well, when we first started, people wasn't really. I mean, everyone can play blast beats and stuff these days, but when we was around, it was like three people in the world could play our music. But these days, it's just. Well, it's not normal, but it's more people have practiced, you know, it's more
commonplace. It's pretty much ubiquitous in this kind of music nowadays to play things that in the music, I mean, say the, not necessarily that we were around at the time, but the music that we were listening to and we'd maybe thinking about doing a band or something, so 20 odd years ago, you know, stuff like that, no one did the things, technically speaking, in terms of the playing and everything that people do in all the time now.
I think it's like it loses the extremity of it as well. It's one of the reasons it's one of the reasons why when I do the music, I just don't try and be as fast as possible or be the most drum hits per second, because it's not. That's not extreme to me.
No.
It's like more about the overall sound. You know, I mean, there's actually a lot more slower bits on the new album, but it still sounds as extreme, I think.
Yeah, but a sort of a collateral part of that increased like technicality that people obsess on, and you know, there are these pages on that you can look on the internet and how many blast beats, how many beats a minute you can play, and how sweep picking and all that kind of stuff. That's like a collateral effect of the of the progression of the music that's taken anyway.
Yeah.
So to be honest, we're not all that interested in the music that people who are doing that write, but it does mean that has become normalised and it's comparatively easy to find people who can play stuff that when we were starting out, we didn't think people could generally play. So nowadays it's a lot easier.
Yeah.
So how long do you spend then with the band members rehearsing before you go out on tour?
Usually it'll be the case that mix over in America. So we'll have the rest of us will have a few goes,
I mean, the thing is these days, if you've got the songs already written and they're already recorded, all you've got to do is listen to it and you can just practice on your own, you know. You don't need to be in a room with someone.
Yeah.
I mean, it does help. We normally just practice to get the band vibe together a little bit, I guess.
Yeah.
Mm.
But
that is that's testament to the quality of the lads we're working with, though. You know, some people need hand-holding. But
everyone's really good and professional, whatever. And we know that when they turn up, they're going to be able to know the songs, and usually it's just that note's wrong, everything else is good.
It's minor alteration. But Steve can play pretty much anything you can program.
Yeah,
he's ridiculous in terms of speed and endurance, things like that. And Jay will he'll listen to it a couple of times, and he'll come in and he'll know his part, he'll know the bit that he's not playing that Mick would play, what the bass would need to do, just by ear.
Yeah.
So they're talented guys, so it makes it easy to...
So how have you come across to them? Are they friends, or...
We've been all been friends and played in bands together for like 10 years or something. More than that.
Dunk longer.
Yeah.
Significantly longer with Dunk.
Dunk, the bass player's been playing in bands since 2000, I think. Mm. 2001. And the other two.
Steve came to record, didn't he?
Yes, Steve had a band and he came to record with me, and I was like, bloody heck, I'm gonna steal him. And then, but he carried on doing his own band as well. And then I think through him, I met Jay or something, the guitarist.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's an organic sort of thing. People you stumble across or whatever, but they turn out to be good ones.
You wouldn't consider bringing them in to write with you?
No. Not that they wouldn't write anything useful, but it's just there's no need. It's like saying, might sound like a bit big-headed. It's like saying to Salvador Dali or something, do you need help with that bit of that painting over there? Because he just wouldn't, because that's his vision, you know, or whatever.
More in terms of him being someone who has a strong vision rather than us being the musical equivalent.
I'm not trying to say we're geniuses, I'm just trying to say alter something, you know, that someone else's idea, you know.
To be honest, but almost every time someone's expressed an opinion about what we should do, I just thought, no. Almost every time. And these are, you know, people who we know well and people who do good musicians in their own right and stuff like that. There's just a certain mindset or something like that that we've got, and it would take ages to explain to somebody else, my brother.
Yeah.
You both have many other commitments. What would you say is your main job?
I could tell you, I could give you a list of things that I do from time to time, but...
I'm the same. Don't really have a main thing of anything.
No.
No, but the main thing is the thing that you're doing at the minute. So at the moment, my main job is being a musician on tour.
Yeah.
But
for this week?
In a couple of weeks' time, I'll have something else that's preoccupying me. Yeah. And I think it's probably worthwhile to see it that way, to be honest, because you focus entirely on whatever it is that you're doing. You do it to the best of your abilities, and then reorient your focus onto something else. Well, that means hopefully, at least, that each of the things is as good as you could make it be. Because if you're thinking that I'm just doing this part time and I've got to go back to what I should be doing, then it seems that your focus is going to be a bit smeared.
I do meet a lot of bands, a lot smaller bands that are sort of making it happen. They've got full-time jobs, and this is like trying to make it in part-time in this.
I think one of the reasons that we ended up not being successful but being able to have a sustained career is the fact that me and Dave never really ever thought of this as being a serious profession.
Yeah.
And we never really spent 100% time on it. It's always been I've wrote some songs, let's do this and that. And we've always had other things going on.
It's 100% at the time.
It's 100% at the time, but we're not this is our life, and that doesn't make it not seem as credible or whatever. But
No, it's, no, because it is 100% at the time.
Yeah.
It's not like
but we've never set out thinking we're going to be famous or whatever. We've always thought, usually thought, who the bloody heck's going to listen to this crap? Usually.
Yeah.
We just did it for ourselves, and then that's I think the same mentality still.
I think there's some kind of weird terminological issue with the way you put it then. They've got full-time jobs, but they do music part-time. I read an interview with Fenris from Dark Throne. He's quite well-known kind of guy. And someone asked him what he did for his day job, and he went spare. He's just shouting at him, and everything got really, really annoyed. And he goes, what I do in the daytime? You're interviewing me about this thing.
Yeah.
This means the world to me, whether it's the thing I spend more time doing than anything else or not. It means the world to a lot of people out there. Why this idea that there's something that's your actual role and that you're deviating from it in some ways? I'm not getting angry myself at you, but that's, you know, that's more the way I look at it. It's in terms of significance.
Yeah.
That's all you need to know.
The
yeah.
bands I've spoken to, I work in the day job to support, to do what they love doing. That's how it come about.
Yeah, yeah, and that might be
so
a better way of doing
not,
it as
yeah,
opposed
not
to
big enough to sell out and make money from what they're doing, having to support that with another income.
That's normal. That's
No, of course. That's perfectly normal.
We're the same too.
Not long ago, I was working 12-hour shifts, 48, 60 hours a week, and all that kind of thing. But I'd never think of that as the principal focus, the main job, or anything like that. That's something I had to do then. I do something
else. It's just isn't it? If I have to pay the bills and do thick stuff. I mean, we're playing like crazy music. It's not like you're going to be on top. The Pops doesn't exist, does it? It's not like we're going to be on the radio and earning royalties and doing this and that. It's just, it's a certain limited kind of audience, you know, and we just do the best you can in that and keep doing it.
You say not on the radio and the likes. You haven't been approached for sort of soundtracks for films and that sort of.
I think we have before, but I think we've had something.
It was like a little independent film, wasn't it?
Yeah, nothing like big or anything.
It does occasionally happen, but usually a film producer isn't someone who knows much about this kind of music. So when they go, right, okay, we want something high octane and all that kind of thing, there are services that exist as auxiliary services in Hollywood and stuff, and that someone says to them, I want music like this, and they find it.
Yeah.
Well, I'll probably give them corn or something, you know what I mean? It's because that's they're in a fairly insular
easier
place.
To find as well,
yeah, exactly. Yeah, we'd be cheaper. But, you know, mates of ours, Napalm, they were in a pretty big Hollywood production. They had a track on the thing, so it crops up every now and again, but it's not really the kind of thing that's likely to happen with us. Yeah. Been on the radio and stuff a fair bit, but films.
Find that more on the radio in Birmingham or national radio?
First radio we did was Radio 1. So.
Yeah.
We did a Peel session, John Peel.
Yeah, I've read about that.
Did that, and we did a radio, a rock show, BBC rock show, was it?
Yeah, the Radio 1 rock show.
Yeah. Did that as well.
I think it was on about 4 o'clock on a Tuesday morning.
But
they pay lip service at least.
I think.
We played on Sirius, weren't we, a couple of weeks ago.
I think so, yeah.
Sirius is like, because obviously America, with
right,
the geography, it tends to be local radio stations. You wouldn't get a state broadcaster very easily. But Sirius does actually broadcast. It's like a satellite system in America. Yeah. You'd have it on your car stereo. We were on that.
Hand-picked.
Were we really?
Yeah.
Hand, he used his hand to pick up the button and press play on the button.
Your 8th studio album released yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In America.
Only
Monday.
UK came up.
It was the day before. This week, anyway. Yeah.
Information is wrong, what can fans expect from it?
Don't know. They can expect it to sound like an album of songs that we wrote, because it doesn't really sound like anyone else, and that they're ones they haven't heard before.
And it's a new album. It's the same. I mean, I can't answer questions like that.
I think it's better if people listen to it and decide for themselves. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's not like you can listen to it for free, for God's sake. If you like it, buy it. Try it.
Sounds like our band, basically, but it's a new one.
It's not going to be like some bands who just be and they come back completely different sound.
Because that to me just sounds like a band who hasn't got a good idea in the first place. That's like.
Yeah, they follow what's in fashion.
Actually, not. But not
I
always,
think
actually.
Of Ulver.
Yeah, I was just going to say, not always. Some a lot of people do have different directions they want to go in. Ours is pretty much a solid, consistent idea, but it does change.
There's progression. And
yeah,
it's,
but I mean, if you played our first album and then played our new album to someone who doesn't know what our band sounds like, yeah, they'd just think it sounded the same, probably.
Yeah, but very possible.
To a fan.
To someone who's into the particular genre of music, there would no big differences, but, you know, yeah, roughly speaking, it's going to be broadly the same, yeah, thing, isn't it? Of course.
Yeah. There's a lot more electronic influences on there. We had an extra guy, one of our friends, come in to do like extra stuff on there, which we haven't done before. Well, we have done it before, but it was done more properly this time.
Knew what he was doing.
Yeah. So that was cool. And that was actually good because it gave me more space to not have to worry about that as well. Yeah. So it came out better.
When you were sound checking, you had some samples playing in the background.
That's what I'm talking about. Yeah.
That's his stuff.
That's his bits.
Yeah, very interesting that too.
Yeah.
Get a bit of different sound in.
Yeah.
But if we wanted to do something that was completely different, we would.
We just
wouldn't call it an Anathrak, we'd call it something else.
Yeah.
Why bother trying to force people to listen to stuff that you wanted to do differently? Just do it, by all means, but don't try and drag people with you. Get people to like it for what it is, why not? You know, Nick Holmes, Paradise Lost. He was in an interview once and they said, the record company did say so, because they changed quite significantly at some point in the career and went quite commercial. Yeah, the record company did say it might be a good idea to. I haven't got a mortgage. I can give a shit what you think.
Yeah.
Not really our style.
You seem surprised when you've got your new CDs that they're plain black. Do you not have any input in that? Or?
We didn't this time. I mean, if we particularly asked for it and, you know, hammered on the record company's door, they'd probably do it, but we didn't know about it at all. So,
It was just a surprise. It was cool. It was like they did the right thing. It's just, it wasn't like we didn't have a say in it. It just happened and it was cool.
I think there was an original, it might have been the second demo we ever did, and that was on Black Sea.
Oh, yeah.
Because I bought them and burnt them on my computer. It was like, you know, this is a basic it was. And I've managed to find black CDRs, but that was the only time that we've been on black CDs before. So
yeah, it's a bit different, isn't it?
Yeah, it's cool.
Just we're really pleased to find that most of the vinyls were matching as well.
Vinyl.
Is there a reason you still do vinyl? It seems to be making this sort of re-emergence now. It's coming back a bit.
Normally, most things we do is because we want one for ourselves.
Yeah. Mm.
That's really it, really.
I've just nicked the coloured vinyls out of the box that were there to sell to people because I wanted one.
Yeah.
I don't even use CDs at home.
No, me neither.
No.
I've got a record player, I've got a CD player, but I've got a hard drive and everything on it and a streamer.
He gave me one copy of our new album about yesterday or the day before, and that was the only copy I had, and I gave it to my brother. I didn't even, you know, that's just where we are. It's like,
to me, it's an object to own, and I do like owning it. I wouldn't say it's pointless to have physical media. I'd cherish a thing, but and also weirdly, if I'm going to listen to stuff that's streamed from a hard disk, I want it to be my rip of it. I don't know why that makes any difference, but as one that's something that I've downloaded from somewhere, it doesn't feel like it's my one, even though it's just a file on a computer. So I do like having the things, but actually listening to them, kind of optional.
I suppose when you've got your own, you won't buy your own. Do you listen to your own stuff? Or?
I don't. You do, don't you?
So you know what it sounds like.
But since,
by the time I finish mixing it, I don't want to listen to it again.
You have to listen to it so obsessively when you're making the thing that by the end of it, you're sick of it.
Yeah.
There's been times when I've been in a pub or something and one of our songs comes on and someone's like, oh, what do you think of this song? I'm like, who is it? It's one of our songs that I completely forgot about, and you can't hear it properly, and it's like, oh, it sounds pretty good. So it's your band. Oh, shit.
I've done that a few times.
Yeah,
as well.
It's like,
it's good we thought it was all right, really.
How important is social media to promote the band, and do you run all of that sort of thing yourselves?
Yeah, we do.
We've got a Facebook site. It's a good way of letting an awful lot of people know some information. Aside from that, I think it's rubbish. I hate Facebook. Nick does it more than me.
That's just the way things are these days. It's just, it's definitely useful, but I mean, I don't know. I don't know any other way. How do we used to do things?
MySpace. Before social media.
When we first started our band,
I remember putting demo stuff on mp3.com.
Oh, that's when we started doing our band, the internet wasn't that popular. It wasn't that such a big thing. It was like 1990. I remember going into college, and you come into college, so we could use the computer and use the internet.
Yeah.
In 1998, when we was doing this, didn't even have a computer.
No.
And I remember making my email address when I first started university in 1999.
I just remember the first official NLNathrak email address.
Crushfuck.
Yeah, crushfuck at fuckyou.co.uk. Strangely enough, the domain doesn't exist anymore. You can't have it. But.
But saying that, though, that most of where we've come from has been from the internet, because some guy heard us on mp3.com, which was basically what everyone used in them days, I guess. A bit like iTunes.
It's kind of like SoundCloud or something like that would be now. It's something completely different now. It got bought. It's mp3.com still exists, but it got bought out, and it's a corporate thing now. But.
Yeah, some guy heard us on that, and he wanted to. Was it wanted to release a demo or something? I can't remember. Was it a song? And then he used a song
Wanted a song for his compilation.
Yeah. That was it.
And then wanted to put an album out as a result of that, I think. Yeah. But the thing is, social media and everything, it's just a fact. It doesn't matter what you think about it.
No.
It's a fact. That's the way the world works. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's not even something as cynical as exploiting the tools available to you. It's living in the world as it actually is. You know, there doesn't have to be anything cynical about that. It's just that's what you do. You have to.
Yeah. So. What's the most recent album you've purchased? And the next question was, do you download or buy a CD? But you've answered that already.
I was going to say legally or...
purchased. I think the last one I bought was the Aphex Twin album. New Aphex Twin album.
I haven't bought an album for 8 years and years and years.
Yeah.
There's actually one I'm waiting for to come out. I'm quite excited that there's a new album coming out, which doesn't happen very often with me. With a really obscure Czech band called Cult of Enzivi. Just completely repulsive and hardly anyone would like them, but you know, I like them.
It's quite nice to have that, waiting for that band to produce them. It's waiting for
sure. Yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah. But one thing I like about being able to buy stuff so easily on the internet is, first of all, I like buying high-quality files instead of MP3s. I hate MP3s, they sound crap. And second of all, how easy it is to get totally different things. Because when I was getting into heavy music and that, there was a shop in Birmingham, and Tempest.
Yeah.
If you wanted to buy some heavy stuff, you had to go to Tempest. But if you wanted to buy anything else, you had to go to the other place. If you buy anything else, you had to go to the other place. So, yeah, the last thing I bought was the Aphex Twin album, but not too long ago I bought an album by Portal. I bought another obscure Czech black metal thing, and I bought a load of Chopin.
Yeah.
And that was, it was all dead easy. I mean, it's all just, it's there in front of you.
Yeah,
so.
You just set your fingers, I want that.
Yeah.
There,
yeah.
What's the first albums you bought, and do you still have them?
First CD I ever bought was when I was 12, because I got a CD player for Christmas, and it was Bolt Thrower.
Yeah.
Fourth Crusade.
Was it?
First CD I actually owned. But the first record I owned was Europe, Final Countdown.
Yeah.
Right.
Actual first thing I owned musically, I was probably like six or something. But first CD was Bolt Thrower.
My first CD was Dark Throne. That's when I got a CD player. I didn't have a CD player for years.
Yeah.
First album I got was Bad.
Well,
seriously, and I've still got it on tape.
Yeah.
Best one.
Still got it. Yeah.
That's all you need, really.
Yeah.
What do you listen to when you're on the road on the tour bus?
Nothing.
No, sat now.
Just get to sleep. Or
don't complain stuff. Depends. That he thinks he's funny on his laptop.
Yeah. Normally.
You're watching Monty Python on the way down.
Sometimes after the show on the way home, and we're all drunk, we might end up listening to King Diamond or some reggae or something.
Oppy Fuelletti.
Aero Storm. Who knows?
Stupid.
Like,
I don't like having too much metal.
No.
If you've all got to listen to it, because you're all stuck in the same place on a fucking cart, then metal all the time just absolutely does my nutty.
first thing that happens when you go to play a festival in a different country, they pick you up, and the first thing they do is put the music on really loud and play some death metal. And
hey, like, guys, you like this?
It's like the last thing you want to do. And they're like, oh, listen, you like this, whatever. It's like, yeah, but not now. You know, look out the window at things.
The other band, I mean, Benediction, because they've got a long history of doing long tours on Nightliners, and possibly more than that, right? And they've got a rule that there is no metal.
Yeah.
And quite frequently on a big Nightline, you'll have several bands together, and you get some Swedish guys or whatever. Hey, let's listen to Celtic Frost. It's like, fuck off, we're listening to Madness. Because you do it all day, you hear it in the gig all day.
Yeah,
you know? Something different,
yeah.
I like a bit of reggae.
And it's not that fun, really. It's not fun. Like most, we got a good
bit
sense
of reggae.
Yeah.
That's the best thing to do.
I think in our band we've got a pretty good sense of humour and stuff, and most of the music we listen to is because it's funny and it's entertaining, not because it's, oh, fucking, listen to this riff, it's really heavy. It's more just like...
Yeah, you do that by
yourself. Pass the time. You want to pass the time and you want to enjoy yourself.
Yeah. Mm.
Listening to Bethlehem isn't really going to make you enjoyable.
Giggle a bit. Yeah, yeah,
a little bit. That was a bad example.
The point stands.
Yeah.
Is there a reason the death metal bands make their logos really difficult to read?
I have no idea.
Yours isn't too bad.
Nah. Ours is ours is slightly readable. But the original logo wasn't very readable. Actually, no, it was.
No, it was quite readable. Yeah, Mick scribbled it. Do a logo, and he went, all right, got a pen like that. And I scanned it and put filters on it, and that was it. It looked like a con shop.
Yeah. I don't know about the logo thing. I think it's a bit silly, but
I think it's monkey see, monkey do. I do.
Yeah, it's totally
copying what they think you're supposed to do.
Yeah,
what you're supposed to do is never what you should do.
It's not the best advertising if you can't read who you're watching.
No, exactly. But at the same time, one of my favourite bands is Circle of Dead Children, and you could do a pub if you were down the pub with a load of mates one night. You could do some kind of sweepstake about who could read the funniest message out of it, because you can't see what it says. I always used to think it looked like they got a turntable, wrote it in Tippex, and then spun the turntable around.
Yeah, it does.
Good work, mate. If you can make an all-star band from musicians dead or alive, who would be in it?
King Diamond.
Bootsy Collins alive.
He said dead or alive.
Bootsy Collins.
I'm pretty sure he's still alive.
Bootsy Collins.
Yeah, Bootsy Collins.
I need to think about this one, because I might miss someone that's amazing.
I'm trying to think who else you need in a band, rather than just cool people.
Oh, no, it's got to be a musician then.
Yeah, but you can have King Diamond, Reiner from Bethlehem.
Yeah.
Bootsy Collins, Shane. Let's have another bass player.
Shane.
10,000 bass players.
Do you want a serious answer or a silly answer?
No, whichever you want.
I could say anyone.
Mendelssohn. Oh. Who's a guitar player that's cool? I can't think of any.
Oh, hang on. Play from Nitro.
Michelangelo.
Yeah.
He held the world record for the fastest guitar playing.
Yeah.
What a piece of shit. Yeah, it's like
there's a simultaneous, like, anti Guinness world record.
Played two guitars like this at the same time.
Yeah, four. I saw him at a guitar show at the NEC.
Hang on, the guitar
comes down from the ceiling. Paul Frog came.
I got his autograph.
Did you?
Yeah. He had a Nitro tattoo on his arm.
Guitar comes down from the ceiling. Yeah. He's like,
yeah, he would be the guitarist.
Yeah. And I'd want the singer from Nitro as the bouncer.
Yeah. Jim Gillette.
Seriously, go on YouTube and put in Nitro Freight Train. Something like that, and look at the idiot of singing, and then find out what he looks like more recently, and stop laughing, because he might not like it. His photo scared the crap out of me. I don't know what he's like in person.
He looks good doing that now.
By all means.
The city of Birmingham has several football teams. Who do you support?
Not interested in football.
No.
Not that, or not against it, just I've never ever had any interest in sports.
I was going to ask, living in America, do you follow any in American sports, but obviously not.
If I was supposed to support a team, I guess it would be Aston Villa, because that's the nearest one I live to.
Would be for me. I went to school about a mile away from the ground. So,
yeah. But, so I guess Aston Villa is an answer, but nah.
I like the spectacle of a really big sporting event. Though. I've been to a couple of football games. Went to San Siro, Milan Stadium, and saw, I think it was Inter that time, against Spartak Moscow, like European Championship. And just
it's cool.
The occasion of it was amazing. And I saw carry on.
Does that make the English fans a little bit poor?
Oh, no, I've not been to it. I went to Twickenham once, but I saw a game at Yankee Stadium. I was in America last time, and that was really impressive. But it's impressive for the spectacle, the actual sport.
Yeah. What's the strangest thing you've ever been given by a fan, and do you still have it?
How many people answer something like herpes?
No one.
You got some amazing pants given to you, didn't you? With "Marry Me" written on them.
Yeah, I have a marriage proposal delivered via pants.
Technicolored as well. Technicolored
pants. Wore them on my head. I was given the really weirdest thing. It wasn't with Nathrak, it was with Benediction. We played in Ukraine, in the bit of Ukraine that you wouldn't go to now, a few years ago, in Crimea. Not far from Simferopol. And a guy turned up there and he handed me this medal. And I asked him what it was, and apparently it was his granddad's, I think it was his dad's. And I think everyone was given one. It was a worker's medal that handed out on retirement, maybe, or something like that, from the old Soviet regime. And I almost had to have a fight with him about it. Because I was going, I'm not taking that. You know, that's personal to you in a way. It can mean nothing to me by comparison, you know. And some guys were translating, and they basically said, take the fucking thing. So I was like, all right, I was kind of blown away by that, and that was a very bizarre thing. I wouldn't think of doing something like that, but it seemed to mean a lot to him. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's a big fan.
I suppose so,
When you're on the road, what do you miss most?
Probably curry.
Yeah,
I usually like to come home and have a big curry after being out. Because the thing about coming from Birmingham is curry in most other places is crap. You might be able to get some of half decent down here, but if you're in Germany or somewhere, don't bother. It's rubbish.
Manzils.
Yeah.
Curry.
Yeah.
Curry, yeah.
That'd be nice.
What's the best venue you've ever played and why?
Trying to think if I've ever played now.
It's been a couple.
The one in Moscow was pretty cool.
Yeah, Moscow was cool because it looked a bit like something out of
Batman 1.
Batman, it was really gothic. Air conditioning tunnel going all down inside and everything. That one had like a video wall.
That one we played in Testament was cool.
Shepherd's Bush. Shepherd's Bush Empire.
That was cool.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. Dressing room was you had to get a taxi to the dressing room pretty much. It was miles away. It was a labyrinthine old building.
I don't know.
We don't talk a great deal, too.
No, we have to know. Because we've been in different bands as well. We've done a lot of stuff. Festivals were always really cool. But I'm trying to think of all the festivals we've played now, and there's too many.
I tend not to remember stages and venues. I remember places. Been to some amazing places. Ghent, Moscow is probably a really good one of them. And the parts of Norway that we've seen, just the clarity of the air and light and the mountains around and all that, it's gorgeous. But a stage is pretty much a stage.
Yeah.
Some are bigger than others.
It's nice compared.
It's
cool.
Yeah, it's alright. I was expecting a little pub.
That's cool.
The White Rabbit is, I fancy, quite a bit smaller.
Right.
Stage-wise, anyway.
Mm-hmm.
This is a bit bigger venue. So.
Yeah, that's good. The stage is a decent size in there. Yeah. You're not cramped like that. But yeah, it's better than I was thinking it was going to be.
Ever had a Wayne's World moment, sort of we're not worthy moment? And if so, who was it?
A Wayne's World moment?
Yeah.
What do you mean by that? Oh.
Don't tell me you haven't seen Wayne's World.
No, but I just wasn't sure which Wayne's World moment, which Wayne's World moment you meant.
Yeah, have you sat in a car headbanging to Bohemian Rhapsody? One of us in a big week. Probably.
Yeah, I mean, you get like people doing that kind of stuff, I guess. I don't know. I don't really pay attention to that kind of stuff.
No, yourself. Yeah.
Oh. No one?
No.
I can't think of one. We'd be like that if King Diamond.
Yeah, if King Diamond was there, that would happen.
Yeah. But can't think of anyone else. Played the same festival, we didn't bump into the chat.
Yeah. Oh. General Levy, maybe a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit.
A little bit.
Yeah, he was
a guy called General Levy. He used to do a jungle song.
Yeah, jungle drum and bass stuff.
Yeah.
A long time ago.
We did a Nevermind the Buzzcocks TV show. He was the other opponent. Yeah. That was cool.
Yeah.
That was cool. Can't really think of it.
Almost nutted Kerry King once by accident. Running down some stairs at Hellfest.
I just thought. Backstage at Brutal Assault, we found our way over to Immortal's dressing room and watched him skip from his dressing room onto the stage, jumped over some.
The thing that made that properly hilarious is because before he came and did it, we were standing there going, wouldn't it be wicked?
Yeah.
Galloping along the cliffs, yep. And then he came did out it? Like that.
That's like a bag before.
One of the funniest things I've ever seen.
He was. One of the funniest things.
And you with that picture, you've got two massive Swedes with corpse paint on, and there's you with some chips.
Oh, that's dark. That was dark.
What was it?
Right, just a few quick fire ones to finish off.
Yeah.
Favourite place?
My flat.
Yeah, my bedroom. I was trying to think of where I've been, but whatever. Too complicated.
Yeah, it's not saying it's the best place that you've been to.
Nah.
My
bed.
Favourite food, you've answered that already.
Yep.
Favourite person.
These are complicated questions.
Yeah, it's just because there's an obvious answer, like your mum or something like that.
You mean like a celebrity or something?
Yeah.
I really like James Hetfield. Always have done. I don't know why, I just feel like I can relate to him in some ways. He's got a really good sense of humour.
I like Slavoj Žižek.
Who's that?
He's a Slovenian cultural studies professor.
Oh, okay.
But I've seen him doing a big interview about how to analyse the different cultures of European nations by their attitude and design of the toilet. He's like, the way they flush their shit away tells you all these psychological facts about it. And just how stupid and bizarre that is.
Tea or coffee?
Both.
Yeah, same here. Coffee when I first woke up, tea for normal.
Yeah. Lager or cider?
Cider.
Both.
Whiskey or wine?
Wine.
Both.
Rum or Coke?
Both.
Rum.
At the same time, rum and Coke.
Yeah, I just don't like Coke very much. Goes well with rum. But.
Classical music or rap?
Classical.
Yeah.
And anything you want to plug?
No.
Don't think so.
No.
Right. Not really big into plugging.
I'll plug my M-Pin in a second.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks,
mate. No worries.
No, cheers.
Thanks a lot.